the secret of success. Wouldn't it be nice if they wrote one of those yellow and black books with the stripes across the front that said, Success for Dummies? You know, I would have one or two of those in my library for sure. Don't you wish there was some sort of a recipe or a manual that just made it simple, that simplified it into these basic steps, follow steps 1, 2, and 3, and step 4 will be success. Wouldn't that be nice if they had a book like that? I mean, I would invest in that if it were true and if it were trustworthy. Well, I believe that Ezra 8 is actually such a thing. It gives a step-by-step description, an explanation to the attentive reader about how we can succeed. Now, bear in mind, the Bible's definition of success is vastly different than the world's definition of success. For students reading Ezra 8 and following the steps to success, the student can't guarantee an A or an A-plus on every exam. And the employee can't guarantee, by reading these steps for success, that they will get the promotion. The business owner can't guarantee that they will make the big sale. The farmers, reading this step-by-step process for success, cannot guarantee a bumper crop each and every year. But these step-by-step description, this step-by-step description of success will teach us how we can honor God and how we can receive His blessing in a simple 3-step process. And I'm going to break that down for you. And those 3 steps are simply this. Step 1, seek God first in every endeavor of your life. Seek God first in every endeavor. Step 2, obey with excellence. Obey with excellence. And step 3, acknowledge God in all successes. Acknowledge God in every success. So seek God, obey with excellence, and acknowledge your success. Acknowledge God in your successes. This week, you only have time to cover step 1. So if you want steps 2 and 3, you're going to have to come back 2 weeks from now, because next week we're going to be having communion, and I want to urge you to prepare your hearts this week for that. But then 2 weeks from now, we'll come back and we'll look at steps 2 and 3. Today, we're going to just focus on step 1, seeking God in every endeavor. In Ezra 8, verses 21 to 23, Ezra is preparing to undertake a return journey to Jerusalem. You may recall that Ezra and his fellow Jews are in exile in Babylon, and God has called them to return to Jerusalem. There's already been one returning group prior to Ezra, many years, about 70 years earlier, the first group returned and ultimately rebuilt the temple in Jerusalem. Ezra is preparing to return with a second group of people. He's about to undertake a journey of 900 miles on foot, and he's going to take 4 months to complete this journey. Ezra, as he prepares to take this journey, reveals for us an important step, perhaps the most important aspect of his preparation. What does Ezra do first? What is the first thing that Ezra does in preparation for this 900-mile trip? Does he pack a lunch? Does he search MapQuest or Google Maps to plan out his route? No. Let's look. Verse 21 of chapter 8 says this. There, by the Alava Canal, I proclaimed a fast so that we might humble ourselves before God and ask Him for a safe journey for us, for our children, with all our possessions. The first thing that Ezra does is fast and pray. He humbly seeks God. He turns to God, asking for success and safety in their journey. They ask God that He would deliver them to their ultimate destination. If you've ever taken a long trip, this may sound familiar. Many of us, when we go on a long trip, a long drive, or a flight someplace, we often will take time and ask God for traveling mercies. We'll ask Him for a safe journey and a safe arrival to our destination. Then we jump in our car, we go. Yesterday, our own mission team left early yesterday morning to travel out to South Dakota to work in the Indian reservation. Yesterday, they traveled just about 800 miles before they reached Indiana last evening. And then this morning, they're already on their way. By now, they've certainly covered more than 100 miles. In the last 24 hours, the Winston Gutters have traveled the 900-mile equivalent of what the Jews traveled in this four-month period. They did it in 24 hours. It's going to take the Jews 4 months. But you better guarantee, I can guarantee you that yesterday, before they left, where's Ray Dan? What did they do before they left?
Pray.
How did they pray? Do you remember, you know?
In a circle.
In a circle, holding hands. It's what they do. Every time they travel, they gather together to pray for God's traveling mercies, for safety, and to deliver them to their destination, as well as all sorts of other things. But they pray before they go. This is exactly what the Jews are doing here. They're praying for this, for these traveling mercies. But unlike the Gutters, the obstacles that the Jews are going to face vastly surmount the obstacles that the Gutters are going to face. First in time, but safety issues. Unlike the Gutters, they're not going to do it in 24 hours. They're going to take 4 months. And the challenges that they faced are far greater. Listen, as Ezra explains exactly what sorts of challenges they anticipate on the journey. Verse 22. I was ashamed to ask the king for soldiers and horsemen to protect us from enemies on the road, because we had told the king, the gracious hand of our God is on everyone who looks to him. But his great anger is against all who forsake him. So, instead of asking the king for soldiers, we fasted and petitioned our God about this, and he answered our prayer. What are the dangers that the Jews are going to face? They're going to face robbers, bandits, inclement weather, exhaustion. They have to deal with elderly people traveling hundreds of miles on foot. They have to deal with young children traveling hundreds of miles on foot. They have to deal with the sun in the day and the chill at night. They have to deal with food and perhaps food shortages in barren areas. Ezra could have asked the king for soldiers to protect them along the way. This would have, for the Jews, minimized that threat of attack. But Ezra doesn't do this. And some people read over this passage and they think, man, Ezra is a fool. He's a fool. They would say Ezra should have used the resources that God put at his disposal. They would remind Ezra that, yeah, God provided that for you. Remember, Ezra, God put you in that position. God put you in favor with the king, so that you could request these resources, this protection as a soldier. Ezra, you're missing the point. Ezra could have asked the king, and the king would have almost certainly given him soldiers. The king endowed him with many wealthy gifts for the temple. Why not a few soldiers? Why didn't Ezra take the time? Why didn't Ezra ask the king? Well, Ezra explains in his own words that he had told the king about God's power. He had expressed his confidence in God's ability to protect them on their journey. And he told the king, you know, we as Jews have no reason to fear. We have nothing and no one to fear because our God is bigger and stronger than any opposition we might face. Well, Ezra spoke. Maybe he spoke before his mind was fully engaged, or maybe he spoke by the Spirit's prompting. We're not 100% sure, but he spoke nonetheless, and he declared his confidence in God's ability. And once he declared that confidence, once he declared that they needed fear anything, Ezra knew that he couldn't go back on his word. He knew that he couldn't say to the king, we trust in our God can deliver us, but could you send some soldiers anyway, just in case? Because he knew how that would look to the king. It would show the king that Ezra really doesn't trust God to provide protection on the journey. That Ezra is just giving lip service to God's ability to protect them. And so Ezra, in his desire to be consistent in his faith, says, I will not compromise the honor of my God. It was more important to Ezra to uphold God's dignity than it was to engage soldiers to protect him from the very real threat of bandits. As I was reading this week in the Psalms, several passages from the Psalms say, just declaring trust in God is better than trusting in chariots. It says, those who put their trust in horses and soldiers and chariots fall, but those who trust in the Lord stand forever. Read through the Psalms, you'll see time and time again that the psalmist declares trust in the Lord better than trust in the vehicles of warfare of the day, no matter how powerful those vehicles may be. Ezra put his trust where his trust should have been, and he stood firm in his convictions. Ezra wanted his words and his actions to line up with one another. He wanted to practice what he had preached because he wanted to be faithful, a faithful witness to God. He wanted God to shine, and he wanted the king to recognize God's power and to see in Ezra and in the people and out of this world trust that defied all logic and all reason. So let's put a pause just a moment on our discussion of Ezra's out of this world trust, his illogical, unreasonable trust in God, which is phenomenal. And let's fast forward a few years to Nehemiah. The books of Ezra and Nehemiah are tied together. Ezra and Nehemiah are contemporaries, and they work together in Jerusalem. Nehemiah is going to follow down the road, the same path that Ezra's going to take in just a few short years. He's going to be bringing the third group of people. When Nehemiah comes to Jerusalem, Nehemiah is going to say to the king, give me soldiers. Nehemiah is going to do the exact opposite thing that Ezra's going to do. Nehemiah is going to say, God has put me in this position so that I can bring these soldiers to protect these Israelites on the journey. He's going to see God's provision through the king. He's going to ask the king to provide an escort, and the king's going to provide that escort so that the Israelites will arrive safely in Israel. And in both cases, we have the same end result. In Ezra's case, they arrive safely. In Nehemiah's case, they arrive safely. In Ezra's case, he seeks God to find out how he should proceed. In Nehemiah's case, he seeks God to find out how he should proceed. In Ezra's case, they arrive safely. In Nehemiah's case, they arrive safely. What's the difference? In Ezra's case, God provides in a miraculous way, in a supernatural way, in a spiritual way. He defends them over 4 months from all the attacks, all the bandits, all the weather, and all the health issues that they might deal with in that journey, and delivers them safely. In Nehemiah's case, he provides in a natural way. We can never just assume that God works in one way or the other. We ask the question, who's right? Was Nehemiah right or was Ezra right? The answer is yes. Was Nehemiah right or Ezra right? Yes, they were. Both of them right. Why? Because they both did our principle number one, our step number one to success, which is they sought God's guidance in their endeavors. Sometimes in life, we will be called to use very normal means of provision, which God has made available to us. And sometimes in life, we will be called to display a faith that goes beyond all reason, defies all logic. It is not an either-or situation. It is a both-and. There is not a right and wrong answer. In Ezra's case, he was called to trust God to provide supernatural protection, and in Nehemiah's, he was called by God to accept natural, normal, earthly protection. But the key is both sought God's guidance in their endeavors, and both would ask God's blessing upon those endeavors. And this is what we are called to do as well in our step number one to success. With every decision that we make, we are called to seek God's guidance. Prior to making the decision, we get down on our knees, we pray. In some cases, we fast, as Ezra fasted, seeking God's guidance. We delve into God's Word to understand His will. We pursue godly counsel, the men and women of the faith, who can guide us with their experience and their knowledge of God's Word. We seek to understand and know God's will for the direction of our lives. Then, once we have sought God's guidance, we make a decision. And then we bless God once the decision is made. Once we have made the decision, we enter into prayer once more. And we thank God, and we ask for His blessing upon the endeavor. And we can apply this to all sorts of different situations in life. We can think about sometimes when we're just asked to simply trust Him to do amazing things in our lives, and we can think about times when God's going to use very normal means. We can even consider the trip that's underway right now, talking about all the preparation that went into that and all the unpreparation that went into that. You can talk about that with every trip that the Gunners have taken. I talked to Sue 2 weeks ago, a week and a half ago, and she said that Ray Kaufman was going on the trip and he was bringing his truck. And I asked her how many people were driving with him. She said 11. I said 11. Okay, so you've got Walt's truck in your car. Walt's truck will hold 4, 5 uncomfortably, 1,500 mile trip. So probably 4. Your car will hold 4. What was your third vehicle before Ray? She said, we didn't have one. We're just trusting that God will provide another vehicle. And it's funny that the day that Willie spoke here about that trip, the next morning, that Monday morning, Ray said he woke up. He said, prior to that, he said, that's ridiculous. The Gunners traveling 1,500 miles to build outhouses for people on a native Indian reservation. That's ridiculous. Waste of gas, time, and money. And then she spoke, and he woke up that Monday morning, and he said, it's just like God was knocking on his forehead saying, guess what? You're going to South Dakota. And he said, I am? He said, yes, you are. And he said, okay. And then they had their vehicle. And I talked with her about several other aspects of unplanned, God-provided means and resources that had just come about in amazing ways, financial, prayerful. You know, we have 15 people total going on that trip, 7 or 8 of which are from our church. The other half, God has brought. It's just amazing how God provides. Now, go to the other side. That's the Ezra side. God has provided people, He's provided means, He's provided resources. And go to the Nehemiah side. What have they done? Well, they contacted an individual who works on that Indian reservation. They planned their route. They did use MapQuest. Or Google Maps, whichever you prefer. They did pack tools and resources, things that they knew they would need. They packed food. They packed donations of clothing that they could give to the people on the reservations. They know what sorts of things they're going to build. They know what sorts of tools to bring with them. So you see that God is working in both ways in this situation. There's one, just one area that you can apply. Think about health. You know, we firmly here believe and pray for healing in people's lives. And we believe that God does it. And we've seen healing. Undescribable, inexplicable healings of amazing caliber. But yet, sometimes God chooses to work through medicine, through doctors, through those care, through that sort of care as well. You've got the Ezra miraculous healing events, and then you've got the Nehemiah. Mundane, and yet nonetheless amazing, wonderful healing events. You know, in some ways, we think of those as miraculous as well. If I were to describe for you the surgery that I undertook a year ago, and tell you about how they went in through my femoral artery and ran a line up through my heart, and then did a U-turn up through my carotid artery and into my brain, and then they ran another catheter inside that catheter up because it was so tiny, I ran that up to my, and then inside that catheter, they ran a small coil of metal up into my brain and filled a tiny aneurysm with tiny platinum metal coils so that my brain wouldn't burst and kill me suddenly and unexpectedly. That's nothing short of a miracle, is it not? And I know that you have many stories like that, where the medicine that God has provided, the Nehemiah means, have been God's provision for you. Your health, many other areas of life. These are just two areas that we can talk about. We can go on and on the rest of the day. We can share with each other experiences of how God works in the Ezra way or the Nehemiah way. But, you know, we can talk about this church as well. 7 years ago, we began the process of raising funds to build a building. 7 years ago, we put together a fundraising committee. And we prayed that God would bring in money. You know, 7 years ago, Diane, we could have said, you know, Diane, we don't need a fundraising committee. We're just going to pray for God to provide the funds. And we're not going to do anything. And we believe that God can do that. Do you believe that God? I believe that God can. In fact, you told me at one point, you said, we can't do this, God. That all this fundraising endeavors aren't going to work. They're not going to bring about the funds that we need to build a building. Well, here we are, $900,000 later. God did provide in Nehemiah ways through the fundraising committee, their endeavors, through generous contributions of small and large amounts. And every time that we count the money of donations and contributions for our fundraisers, there is more in it. So I tell the people, count the money two or three times. Because each time they count it, there's more money in the pot. And somehow it gets there. And I am not exaggerating. You can talk to Raylene about how much money when they leave the yard sale, they have this much money, and when they arrive at the church, they put it in, they double count it, and there's more there. And it's inexplicable. They can't explain it. God works in Ezra and Nehemiah ways. So 7 years ago, we could have sat on our butts and said, God, you do this. And if God wanted to, which we believe he did and does, he would have done it. And we could have said, we're trusting like Ezra that you're going to provide this money. And it would have come. But sometimes he wants us to work and to learn through the process. There are so many lessons that we have learned over the last 7 years of this fundraising, of this mission work, and these ministry endeavors. God has taught us in the process. We can never miss out on that process because God does teach us valuable lessons along the way. Ezra chose supernatural protection after seeking God's guidance, and then he honored God. Nehemiah chose natural means of protection after seeking God's guidance, and then he honored God. What is the key? What is the first principle? Seeking God's guidance in every endeavor of our lives. Then we can honor him. Pray that that's what we will do, and I invite you to pray with me. Father, we have many decisions to make in life, many challenges to face, many joys to experience, many sorrows to overcome and to live through and to grow from. Father, we thank you for each and every circumstance in life, and we ask that you will help us as we make the decisions, small and large, to seek first you, your kingdom, and your guidance, so that every decision that we make will be something that honors your name and brings you glory. Father, we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Stand now to receive the benediction, and then we will sing our recessional hymn.